Welcome to our continued study of the book of Hebrews. As you will recall from our previous lessons, we have divided this book into 5 sections. As you will recall, we have already covered the first 3 of those 5 sections. In the first section, the supremacy of Christ, the writer showed us, first of all, told us that in the past, God spoke to us through the prophets, but now he speaks through his Son. And then the writer went on to prove that Christ was better than everything and everyone. And then in that same section, the writer gave us the first 2 of the 5 warnings that are found in this book. In the second section, the warning against the snare of apostasy, we saw the 3rd warning, this warning against falling away. Then in this 3rd section, which we spent several lessons on, the superiority of Christianity, the writer showed us how Christianity is greater than, is superior to everything else, the New Testament, the new promise is better and supersedes the old one in every way. So now in this lesson, we are going to cover the last 2 sections of this book, the standard of Christian behavior and the supplication and greeting. So we'll start our lesson today with the standard for Christian behavior, this section 4. And so I'd like you to follow along in your Bibles as we read the first 6 verses of chapter 13. Chapter 1. Keep on loving one another as brothers and sisters. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by so doing, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. Continue to remember those in prison as if you were together with them in prison, and those who are mistreated as if you were yourselves suffering. Marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. For God will judge the adulterer and all the sexual immoral. Keep your lives free from the love of money and to be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me? So let's take a closer look at this section we have just read, chapter 13, verses 1 through 6. As we saw, the outline shows us the section, we started out with brotherly love, let brotherly love continue, and then let marriage be held in honor, and finally keep oneself safe from the love of money. So let's take a look at each of those in turn. Basically what we have here are the final words and loving application. So we see here are the behaviors that will impress a secularized society. In other words, we are to be the calling cards of Christ. People, non-Christians, ought to see us and want to rise to our level of living. And we are supposed to provide examples for the society. First of all, keep love and purity central. Let brotherly love continue, he tells us in verse 1 through 3. There's shared hospitality and mutual caring. Be hospitable and generous, even to strangers. He says, you never know, you may be entertaining angels. Empathize with those who suffer, he tells us. And then in the second section, verse 4, let marriage be held in honor. He says, marriage is a God-given and honorable. God views sexual infidelity honorable. He takes that seriously. And the breakdown of the home leads to the breakdown of the society, he tells them. And finally, in verses 5 and 6, keep yourself free from the love of money. The sign of Christian life is contentment. So be happy with what we have, he's admonishing us. Greed free. God is able to supply life's necessities. Love of money is a substitute for faith on God's provision. And we can see that in 1 Timothy verses 6-10. So let us continue on with our lesson as we read this next section, chapter 13, verses 7 through 19. Verse 7, remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by eating ceremonial foods, which is of no benefit to those who do sin. We have an altar from which those who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. The high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make people holy through his own blood. Let us then go to himself outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. And do not forget to do good, to share with others, for such sacrifices God is pleased. Have confidence in your leaders and submit to their authority, because they keep watch over you as those who must give an account. Do this so that the work will be a joy, not a burden, for that would be of no benefit to you. Pray for us. We are sure that we have a clear conscience and desire to live honorably in every way. I particularly urge you to pray so that I may be restored to you soon. So let's unpack this section that we have just read. We read chapter 13, section 7 through 19. So we saw that this, from the outline, that this section breaks into five smaller subsections. Remember your leaders. Do not be led astray. Do not neglect to do good. Obey your leaders and pray for us. Okay, so let's look at each of those in turn. First of all, remember your leaders, verses 7 and 8. The mark of faith is to carry forward the teachings of godly leaders who have influenced our lives, he tells them. Each of us owes something to mentors, he reminds them. These changed over the years, but they pointed us to the unchangeable Christ. All things pointed to Christ is what he's saying. And then he goes on, do not be led astray, verses 9 through 15. He tells them, he speaks of the tendency of seeking God's approval by engaging or not engaging in certain practices. These strange teachings have no value, he tells them. Christ's sacrifice put an end to empty rituals, no longer having a need for buildings and rituals and altars. He did away with that altogether. Chapter number 3, do not neglect to do good, verse 16. True faith is marked by compassionate sharing. Such sacrifice versus rituals pleases God. Because ultimately God was not pleased with the rituals. Because those sacrifices were only made by those human priests, only had the ability to cover the sin, to lay something over it so that God wouldn't see it and be offended by it. Whereas Jesus's sacrifice took away the sins, the Holy Lamb that takes away the sin of the world. Continuing, number 4, obey your leaders, verse 17, urging to respect and for compliance of those who lead the people of God. And finally, in this fifth section, pray for us, in verses 18 and 19, we see a continuing effort on thought of support. The continuing thought of supporting leaders. The writer asks for personal prayer, then bestows upon them a benediction of unusual power and beauty. In these coming verses 20 and 21, we'll see that in a minute. So this concludes this section, the standard of Christian behavior. So let us continue with the final section of this wonderful book. As this book draws to a close, the author leaves us with a supplication and greeting in the final few verses of chapter 13. Chapter 13, verses 20 through 25. Verse 20. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I urge you to bear with my word of exhortation, for in fact, I have written to you quite briefly. I want you to know that our brother Timothy has been released. If he arrives soon, I will come with him to see you. Greet all your leaders and all the Lord's people. Those from Italy send you their greetings. Grace be with you all. So the writer leaves us with this wonderful benediction in closing, the supplication and greeting. Among the most powerfully worded blessings in the Bible, we can see verses 20 and 21. I'll just read it briefly for you. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the central covenant brought back from the dead, our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of sheep, equip you with everything good, doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. So that is one of the most beautiful prayers, found in the Bible. Anyway, we see in that section a concern for spiritual growth. We see that it's made possible by this God of peace, a new peace shared by the justified blood of the eternal covenant, the new power, the resurrection of Jesus, a new and living way, his shepherd care, Jesus, our high priest, indwelling life of God, worship and service, equipping of spirit, spiritual gifts, aim to please God, a new purpose in life, and finally, eternal glory of Jesus, superiority of Jesus. So, and then we see these closing words in 22 through 25, this affectionate greeting, brothers, you know, Timothy is released from prison, and then he lets them know that he greets the leaders. This is another reason that we know the writer had to be someone that was in Paul's circle, not Paul, but in his circle, for he knows Paul's little son in the faith, Timothy. He greets the leaders, and the letter, when the winds of change blowing, people are tending to cling to familiar things, he's admonishing them and showing them, telling them to resist this change. And it was too threatening. There's a need to recognize these things that cannot change and embrace the things which must change. And with that, this wonderful book, this beautiful book comes to an end. It's funny that he says he's written to them briefly. What did he say specifically? He said, brothers and sisters, I urge you to bear with my word of exhortation, for in fact, I have written you quite briefly, 13 chapters, quite briefly. I hate to see what a long letter would look like from this writer, but this, as he says, this brief letter has come to a close. And I've said he all along, but really, I am one of the few who believe the writer to be a woman, to be Priscilla. So although I've said he all along, I really mean she. So with this wonderful book comes to a close. It has been my pleasure to study this book of Hebrews with you, and I look forward to studying the next book with you. So if you have any questions in the meantime, please feel free to email me. But in the meantime, until we meet again, be blessed.